episode 55.
And then on the bottom of the bottle is an emboss of our name. And on the very bottom, there's also our logo. So we had a couple kind of custom designs in the actual glass itself.
Hey, everybody. I have to tell you about LA Food Adventures. LA Food Adventures is starting food tours here in the Los Angeles area. We are now booking for Santa Monica, Venice, walking food tours. So what the fork is a walking food tour? Great question. First of all, super, super, super fun. I will be hosting them. They will be starting in the middle of April on Fridays and Saturdays. We will visit 6 restaurants. That means 6 delicious tastings that will fill your belly and make you smile. There's going to be wine and beer tastings at some, not all, and socializing all along the way. So if you go to lafoodadventures.com, you can book your tour. If you're new to town, if you're single, if you're celebrating a birthday, anniversary, or if you're just visiting, or maybe you want to gift a tour to friends or family that live in LA or are going to be visiting LA, this is such an awesome opportunity to be swooped around town, tasting and socializing and discovering all along the way. So I host We Explore. Let's do it. Starting middle of April. April 13th and 14th are already sold out, but the following weekends, we are filling up fast. So please visit lafoodadventures.com and book your spot now. This episode is sponsored by Touch Bistro. Welcome back, everyone. Hello, hello. This is episode 55 of the Global Just Forking Around podcast, where every week I showcase a rotating cast of guests, all from the beautifully insane, sexy world of food adventures. I am your host, Debbie Salzberg, and also your number one connection for fine dining, entertaining, and food adventures in Los Angeles. And we are about to embark on episode 55, which is such a good one. It's so juicy. It's full of amazing intel. And we are sitting down with Pia Carasone. Now, Pia is the owner of Republic Restoratives Distillery in Washington, D.C. Badass co-owner. You might recognize her name, Pia Carasone, because she's no stranger to the Hill. She spent years on the Hill working with many politicians and congresspeople. And her last gig, this is, I think, in 2011, she was actually the chief of staff to Congresswoman Gabby Giffords. She's the Arizona Congresswoman Gabby Giffords. And there was an assassination attempt that happened in 2011. And we talk about that. And that was definitely a pivotal turning point for Pia Carasone, launching her from politics to booze. So that definitely was a serious situation that happened. We definitely touch on that, talk on that. Other things we talk about is Republic Restoratives, where that name came from, their crowdfunding campaign, the decision to start Republic Restoratives, some of their labels on their booze. I mean, Rodham Rye. it's a great episode. I don't want to give away too much. I know I always say that, but let's just get right into it. So without further ado, please enjoy this episode with Pia Carasone. Politics and bourbon. Catchy, true, yet this perspective we are about to view may not be what first came to mind when I said politics and bourbon. So Pia Carasone, do you recognize that name? Well, she has extensive experience and contributions on the Hill, which is something I've always wanted to say, up on the Hill. Seriously, the story, the life of Pia, who, with her co-founder Rachel, are the owners of Republic Restoratives Distillery in Washington, D.C., the only crowd-funded distillery in the country, or world, as it may be, just a phenomena. I mean, think about it. Crowdfunded by the people because they are the supporters of the company. They want this company. They feel a part of this company. And, you know, Pierre Carcon's journey, how she got to this exact point in time. Strap in because the adventure is full of emotion, determination, calculation, and sheer inspiration. Pia, hello.
Hi, Debbie.
Welcome. Mm-hmm. Welcome to the Just Forking Around podcast. Thank you so much for joining.
Well, thanks for having me.
Excellent. So let's do this. Let's kick off the podcast episode as we do with all, with a toast. I'm going to raise my warm cup of coffee and bottled water to you. And maybe you can tell us, raise your glass or bottle and give us a toast.
Absolutely. I've got some cold coffee and water. So cheers to that.
Cheers. All right. Oh, nice. I like the sound. So Pia, did I say your last name right? Carcon?
Yes.
Awesome. I mean, we have to start off a little bit with your background, but I'm curious. So what was it like, Pia, when you, at the dinner table, at the Carcon dinner table? I think you grew up in Saratoga Springs, New York?
I did. Yep.
What was it like at the dinner table?
That's an interesting question. My parents worked together. They still work together. My dad is an attorney and owns a very small practice, solo practice in town there. And my mom works in the office. So to be honest, it was kind of a constant barrage of discussion of, you know, current events, local stuff happening, clients, business, you know, all the things that would bore a child and teenager enough to eat as quickly as possible and have to leave.
So did you sit down for dinners? And I'm just trying to get a vibe of the scene growing up.
We did. My parents were sort of firm on dinner together. So basically every evening we sat together.
That's nice. I always feel like it's not this foundation for people's kind of future. I don't know. It seems to be the theme.
Yeah. That's interesting.
Yeah.
Hadn't thought of it, but it was, annoying at the time, but I obviously look back on it and applaud them for making that happen in the middle of a busy life.
Yeah. Amazing. So we're going to talk about Republic Restoratives because your distillery is just, I mean, amazing. I mean, I haven't been able to enjoy the spirits yet, but I will at some point soon, but the visual, and we'll get to that in a minute. But I know the trajectory of how you got to here in this point of time has a very colorful trajectory. What can you tell us a little bit about your time on the Hill and kind of maybe the past few years and how you kind of led up? Because when you think about it, you know, you own a distillery and then the politics. And I know that booze and, you know, bourbon and politics definitely go together. However, with your background and then kind of opening up a distillery, it's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, people often say, so like politics has driven you to drink, which isn't totally inaccurate. But no, I was working on Capitol Hill for a few different members of Congress. Most recently, Congresswoman Giffords from Tucson, Arizona, who most people never heard of until January of 2011, when she was nearly assassinated outside a grocery store on a Saturday morning. And obviously that changed the course of everyone's lives that that were involved with Gabby and myself included. And that was sort of the impetus for this project. You know, we had been talking about how much fun it would be to open a distillery for a long time. But, you know, you probably have those conversations with your friends where you're just sort of like dreaming aloud and, you know, thinking about a new life, a different dynamic and what could you make of it? But this project kind of kept coming back and back in the conversation. And we were both, you know, really interested in it. And Rachel had even spent some time interning in Seattle and really kind of beginning to study some of the more hard science aspects of the business. But then when the shooting happened, it provided kind of the emotional gut check to, you know, go out and do something with your life that you, you know, have always wanted to do. And obviously a reminder that life is short and can change at any moment. So it wasn't immediate. I mean, there were, you know, a full year of work still on my end with the congresswoman and the office while she was recovering and her retirement from Congress and her husband Mark's flight to his last space flight. Yeah. In the middle of all of that. It was a chaotic time, to say the least. And then I continued though in public service. I went to the Department of Homeland Security for about a year, worked with Secretary Napolitano on her public affairs and press, and then left after the Sandy Hook shooting, when Gabby and Mark, who, you know, now were no longer my bosses, but were my friends, you know, we were in sort of constant communication. When that shooting happened, that became the moment for them that they wanted to really enter into the debate about gun violence in America and what could be done to stop it. And so I decided to join them in starting up an organization to combat gun violence in the U.S., which is now called Giffords. And they're obviously continue to be very active. But anyway, throughout that process, Rachel and I were continuing this discussion. And one thing led to another that provided us the kind of confidence to take the next step. We began to look for property and figure out where we could actually open a distillery right in the capital there in Washington. And yeah, I mean, we can go more into that, but it's, you know, it's one of those conversations that you just assume at some point something will come up that will stop it from happening. But we were just able to get over each of the hurdles to the point that we were eventually signing a lease, a 10-year lease on the space.
Was that in 2000? So in 2012, that was, so you spent the 2011 to 2012 still with on in the Homeland Security position. And then I'm just trying to get a timeline. 2012 is when you guys decided to start moving forward and looking for space.
It was a little longer than that. It was like 2011 and 12. I was still on the Hill with the congresswoman's office. 2012 into 13 at Homeland. And then 2014, really beginning my work, you know, on gun violence prevention. And at the same time, you know, beginning to get serious with Rachel about making this project happen. We opened the doors of the distillery in May of 2016. So there was a full 2 to 2.5 years of prep that went into actually opening the doors.
I mean, because opening a distillery, that's not an easy, I mean, you couldn't probably have picked a more layered, pretty intense.
Turns out that's right, yeah.
I mean, so 2 years is actually kind of not that long. I mean, besides from making the booze and the spirits, you actually have to go through all the licensing and the red tape, I'm sure. You know, and then the structure, and then you kind of have to find a distiller. I mean, that's an incredible journey, I'm sure, over those 2 years. So this, I find it interesting because you're, you know, a total entrepreneur, you know, a maker. So it's kind of inspirational as well, right? So you have this idea and you're like, okay, we've been talking about it for a decade. And then obviously your trajectory of your history, which kind of was like life-changing. I'm sure you asked the questions of like, what am I doing with my life? Or what do I really want to do? Because it's short. So you're like, okay, we're going to make this happen. So you said the hurdles that you overcame, it just kind of started moving forward. Was it this sheer determination, eye in the prize, or did you just go for it?
Yeah, I mean, it's a combination of determination, a sense of blind confidence that, like, if other people can figure this out, we certainly can. And then a healthy dose of luck, because the like every region has its own challenges to opening a distillery. In an urban setting in Washington, the challenge was space. So you can imagine if we were in like the rural hills of Virginia or Maryland, space wouldn't be our issue. We would have options. It wouldn't be the price tag on per square foot wouldn't be as daunting. Whereas in the city, it's like, you know, that's the whole deal. Combined with like access for delivery trucks and access for consumers, et cetera. So that was kind of really our initial big challenge. And then it was, of course, building out a space in the middle of an urban setting is way more expensive than it is in the, you know, rolling hills of the South somewhere. So add all that together, those were sort of like the big challenges. And the space part, to some extent, was luck. You know, Washington, D.C. is not that big. We were looking all over the city. There's only certain areas that we could have opened, you know, meeting zoning and et cetera. And so we just sort of right place, right time, found an incredible building that happens to be on a major thoroughfare. And you know, we got the lease done, and that was really the moment that sort of like, okay, this is for real, this is happening.
Yeah, and so you signed the lease before now, because I know you were getting, you did a massive campaign and you know, doubled your min on your Indiegogo and kind of had some accolades with them and became kind of the flagship, I think, for structure of shareholding. We can get to that in a minute. Yeah. But did you sign a lease before you were funded? Like, how did that?
Yes, we did.
Okay.
that's where the blind confidence came in. We were like, well, we'll figure this out. We have enough for a first, last security, and we'll just kind of figure the rest out.
Because you knew you need the space first, so you can't even kind of dream until you had the ground.
Exactly. Yeah. For us, other people can. Other people can say, "Oh, well, we'll sort it out," because they're in a less competitive, you know, real estate market. But that was not the case in Washington. So,
wow, that's incredible. So you get the space. So then, I just think it's so spectacular. So you have this like whole history, right? Of like you're up on the hill. You probably have a lot of connections. You're somehow, I don't know what's in your mind, but you're gonna maybe in the spirit of naming naming your each bridal after something important or something that you stand for. I mean, there's such layers to it of how you kind of launched these products. So when you were doing your campaign for Indiegogo, did you already know the booze you were gonna the spirits you were gonna craft and the names and all that, or how did that go? Yeah, how did that work?
No, we didn't. It's really been a very iterative process. We knew at that point that we would be launching with a vodka, because we had started the process of designing the custom bottle and the branding on that. But no, the rest of it has sort of come along, really just like as everything has developed and we've sort of figured it out a little bit more in terms of like the market and what's doable and, you know, the resources we need to launch a brand, et cetera. So, you know, we knew for sure we were getting in the business to make whiskey. That was never the question, but, you know, exactly what kind and, what would we do between, you know, when we were opening and our own in-house whiskey would be ready to release, and all of that, we didn't really know. We just knew like we'd figure it out. And that's, you know.
Yeah. And that's what's happened.
People often ask me, like, you know, I'll speak on panels about entrepreneurship and they'll sort of say, like, what's the best advice? And, you know, for us, it was really like having a level of confidence that, like, although you can't see around more than maybe one or two corners at a time, you'll sort it out. You know, you just have to have the ability to kind of like calm yourself, sleep well at night, knowing only so much about what's going to happen tomorrow, and surrounding yourself with, you know, a good team, making good decisions, having a good process, and knowing you know, the rest will come.
It's amazing. And that's true. I think that there's, it takes a certain type of, it's a faith and a confidence, and it's going to work out. I mean, it's a combination of that. So now you have like this Indiegogo campaign, which I find to be phenomenal. Cause I feel like, I don't know, Pia, is it like a campaign feels to me like Indiegogo or raising money is almost like what you would do to run a campaign in politics. I mean, is that similar or is it
totally
like
yeah.
grassroots kind of strap it in and kind of, you know, by your bootstraps and kind of hit the pavement, it seems.
Yeah. I mean, there was this sentiment that kept coming up as we discussed this project with friends, family, coworkers, which was that people were really rooting for us and feeling like we were the underdogs that we are. We knew it, but people were instantly realizing it, you know, a combination, whether or not it's, you know, the fact that we're two women, which is unusual, or we don't start the project off with, you know, a ton of sort of institutional money or, you know, family money. Right. Some people get into this and they have a complete blank check and they can build out a $15 million facility and just not worry about anything.
Right.
In fact, most people, that is the case for most people, we realized, right? It's also our age. We go to these conferences and the vast majority of the owners are retired. They're like 55 plus, they've got money in the bank, and this is like something they want to do to ride out their days. And so, you know, anyway,
that's a whole different, yeah, because you said you went and you did a lot of quote research, right? You went to like 100 distilleries, and it's like, I'm sure you were probably like, okay, wait, that's kind of not what we're, and you probably found out a lot of what you maybe,
either who we aren't or what we didn't want to be, is what we realized. So anyway, so this sentiment kept coming up, and you know, we needed funding, and we knew we had a lot of people that were able to support us, but basically none of them would be able to support us at the level that the law, and I don't want to get too corny about this, but that the law would allow you to invest in, right? Like you can't just take an investment from anybody on the street. There's law that governs that. And we can get into that in a minute about Indiegogo, but we knew we could like raise a lot of $100 donations, people that would trade their early money for maybe a bottle, a pre-order bottle of spirit. And, you know, I've donated to Indiegogo and Kickstarter campaigns before for simply a t-shirt or even just like the, you know, the gratitude.
Yeah, yeah.
Like a
thing. I have too.
But we actually could like trade spirit. So that became an option for us. And we just decided, all right, let's do it. Let's launch it. Let's treat it like a campaign for me at least. And, you know, we put some time and effort into the video and yeah, it worked out really well. We were met with, a huge response from, you know, initially friends and family, but then it grew to people we had never heard of, you know, a lot of whom lived in the market that we were about to open. So now all of a sudden we've built like a pre market for folks that were excited about the project, which certainly helped us as we launched.
So there was something about unique about the Indiegogo campaign where there was, wasn't there only a few flagship companies, startups that they choose, and then kind of yours was one of the projects.
So, I think. Yeah. Okay. So we did two Indiegogo campaigns. The first one we did was in May of 2015. We launched it on Kentucky Derby Day. And it was a 30-day campaign, and it was what they call a perk campaign. It's a traditional crowdfunding campaign that you've all heard of, that, you know, you give a little bit of money and you get a t-shirt back or whatever. And that worked out super well. And that laid the foundation for us to go out and raise a little bit more traditional money, and then eventually convince a community bank to give us a loan. Fast forward about a year and a half later, it was October 2016. I was volunteering for Hillary Clinton's campaign in Arizona, and Indiegogo was getting ready to launch a new platform called Equity Crowdfunding. And this is a big deal in the world of finance and crowdfunding, because the law changed a few years back. Obama signed a law called the Jobs Act that basically allowed for lower level equity crowdfunding. So prior to that, SEC law would govern this area and say, unless your like net worth is over $1 million, you're not able to actually invest financially in a company, which obviously excludes the vast majority of Americans.
So, yeah, exactly.
and really hurts a company like ours, because our network is not really full of any, you know, really anyone, you know, save for a handful, but most of our friends and family don't qualify for that. So law changes, Indiegogo then goes out to start to figure out who might be interested. And yeah, we were lucky enough that they came to us because we had been, you know, a fairly prominent perk crowdfunding campaign that they asked us if we wanted to do equity, and came at the right time because we needed a little bit more cash, and we're super excited to be part of something as groundbreaking.
Well, I wanted to get into your brands because I saw a picture of you and Hillary Clinton. Yeah. I was like, oh, okay. No big deal. Just sipping the Rodham, was it the rye?
The Rodham, yeah.
Yeah, totally. I'm assuming it was the rye, yeah. Because, so there's a lot of, so looking back, if you had advice on Indiegogo or campaigns like that, I mean, that must have taken, it takes a lot of prep, right? You can't just start a campaign. I mean, it's not an overnight. I mean, you planned, I'm sure, right? I mean, that's had
totally.
To have been, yeah.
Yeah, and people come to us for advice on this a lot now. And the best thing I can say is you don't just like post a campaign and money falls from this. So you have to give people something to invest in and make them feel like they're really part of it. You know, they're obviously not giving you, you know, their small dollar donations, you know, simply for the perk. There's a sense that they want to belong. And that's the part that, you know, is about creating a good, you know, campaign and communicating with people regularly throughout it.
Yeah. And what's, so Republic Restoratives, how did that name come to fruition?
Oh my gosh. Well, the naming process at our company is historically epic.
Okay.
Rachel and I talk each other in and out of everything. It goes on forever. It's just a nightmare. So we had decided, what we knew going into it is that we would be what you would call a house of brands, not a branded house. So our spirits, we knew, wouldn't be called Republic Restoratives. So the company name was sort of an umbrella name. And therefore, we didn't mind that it was kind of a little bit long. I mean, Republic Restoratives is slightly a mouthful. But, you know, we basically, you know, with that, wanted to kind of like tip our hat to the fact that, you know, we're in the nation's capital, but not be, you know, overly federal, as they would say, and some businesses in DC can fall into that trap. And restorative is an old term, you know, pre-prohibition term used to describe alcohol. And
I didn't know that. So,
yeah. Yeah. I mean, you can't, you know, nowadays, obviously legally, you can't claim the health benefits of alcohol, but there was a point in time when you could. And yeah, restoratives was, you know, that was a word to describe all sorts of tinctures and things that you'd find at your local apothecary.
Ah, nice. So I'm just curious as to, it was a house of brands versus the branded
house. Yeah, versus a branded house. Exactly. So, you know, the comparison there is, you know, we would be producing multiple spirits, all named differently, all branded differently, and falling under the umbrella of Republic Restorative.
Ah, that's brilliant. So I definitely want to get into the products, but I want to know, because your distillery is so cool, the pictures I've seen, and I can just imagine. I mean, it just looks fabulous. It has, so can you explain it a little bit? And I know, I'm curious as to, you, it seems like you actually have a, I'm going to put my Boston on, a bar. Like you have a bar, you got a bar, and it looks like you. Can, I mean, just like looks so open, and it has like glass. I don't know. Can you explain a little bit? Because it's super sexy and it looks sustainable too.
Yeah. No. Thank you. In doing all this research, we noticed that most people's distilling equipment was not visible to the public. So it's, you know, usually behind, you know, closed doors. You know, usually like a windowless manufacturing facility, essentially. And because we had this great building kind of, you know, secured, this, it's on a corner. If you know Washington, the street is New York Avenue. It's a major thoroughfare connecting Maryland and DC. And we're right on a corner there. There's something like 90,000 cars that drive past us every day.
Wow.
So what's like a better advertisement for what we're doing than actually showing people literally what it looks like, you know, on the inside? And being able to watch us work, which, yes, has turned into slightly looking like we're in a zoo. But outside of that, we're excited about it. And it fits with kind of what we talk about in terms of transparency in this process. So we really leaned heavily on glass as a material. And then sort of in the middle of the planning phase of this project, the local law changed to allow us to essentially have a cocktail bar associated with our business.
How did that change? Sorry, Pia. I'm just curious, like, did somebody lobby for that, or is that, that's an interesting switch.
It is. So like the whole industry is super, you know, super regulated by federal government has their hand in it, and your local government, usually your state, in our case, it's our city because we don't have a state. And they have a lot to say about, you know, how and when and where you serve alcohol. So typically, you know, historically speaking, if you were a federally licensed distillery, you would not be able to also have a what people would call a liquor license, right? What you commonly know as a liquor license, because of post-prohibition era law that wanted to separate the manufacturer from the retailer, the three-tiered system, people probably know that.
Yeah.
So fine. But then in more modern time, as people have been opening these distilleries, these craft distilleries, and they've become a real like destination, you know, a lot of state and local officials have found a way to offer an exemption, essentially. So we don't have a liquor license. We can't serve you beer or wine or even spirits that we don't create. But when you come into our facility, you'll see a bar that to the average consumer, they think that it just looks like a bar to them. And what we make there are cocktails that are made from our spirits. And so DC grabbed a hold of this opportunity. DC loves nothing more than to kind of like jump ahead of Maryland and Virginia.
Yes.
Big competition there. So they really were on the forefront of really in all 50 states of creating a very favorable environment for distilleries to flourish. So that was exciting for us because, yeah, having
that's kind of huge, right? I mean, that's like, that's awesome.
Big change. And, you know, it's revenue that we weren't expecting, and its ability to bring people in, you know, not just for a tour once and then never come back, but like a destination that they can, you know, be visiting frequently.
So can you buy direct to consumer? Can the consumers buy the bottles there and walk out with them closed? Yeah.
Yes. Cool. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so we can serve cocktails, we can sell bottles, and do events and tours, stuff like that. So yeah, we used a lot of glass, a lot of steel, and then we left the building otherwise as, you know, true to form, original as we could. It's kind of it's an old, you know, concrete, you know, structure warehouse that a few of the architects we had tour it were really kind of like nerding out about how they don't make buildings quite like that anymore.
So
we
cool.
really left as much of it intact as possible. Yeah.
And then I think you have, I love that there's a, you know, the sustainability side, but there's also, I mean, everything that goes into it. I mean, you have to deal with the water, right? And then you have to deal, I mean, there's so many, the stills and then how you're going to, you know, you have these puncheon casks that we can get into. I mean, there's just, there's all these different levels of how you do, how you are doing things. There was something about the water. You have it on the roof. So it recirculates to cool. I mean, that's so interesting.
Exactly. So the process of distilling is pretty water intensive. Not only do you need to use water to brew, so you know, when you're starting the process out, you're taking whole grain and adding hot water to it to begin the conversion from starch to sugar. And so there's hot water there, but then also in the actual distillation process, you're using often using cold water to condense the hot spirit, vapor spirit into liquid, right? So that's where we saw an opportunity to save some water because it's a closed system, if you will. It doesn't actually like touch the spirit ever. So why use fresh, clean water from the tap when you could like reuse it? So we're using kind of a holding tank on the roof for our condenser water, and it's working pretty well. It's not perfect, but it's, you know, we're continuing to tweak it and make sure that like we can adjust to the seasonality, et cetera. But yeah, I mean, any chance we can get to save water is, you know, obviously the right thing to do. And it's also good from a business perspective.
Yeah. And then, so I know that you and Rachel, obviously the founders, and so you own the distilleries, but is it Rusty? Who's the distiller?
Yeah, Rachel. So Rachel's the distiller.
Okay, cool. I didn't know if Rusty or Rachel. I wasn't sure. I know her background is in that arena.
Yeah. Yeah. Rachel's our head kind of distiller and production person. And we've got a growing team of people involved in that, which has been really fun. We've had some women actually come to us looking for jobs, be able to hire a few folks to work on the production floor, which is great. Yeah. So yeah, we've had to learn a lot, but Rachel's done a great job, and we're.
So do you distill? I mean, do you consider yourself a distiller? Like, are you if like if everybody, everybody left for you and you were there, would you be like, I got this?
No, not at all. I'd be like, we should turn this thing off and go home. I mean, no, I know my way around it, but it's no, I don't really, you know, go to work every day and run the still.
I think it's interesting because that's what, as an entrepreneur, I mean, that you have to know what you are at to excel, what you can contribute, right? And then where the little gaps are to fill it in and then be the one that kind of is able to note that, you know?
Mm-hmm. Totally. You have to be able to know what you know and what you don't know. And that's been a big part of our kind of ethos as we started this project up, that we don't know everything. We're going to hire, you know, for the sort of holes in our knowledge and seek as much advice as possible, which I think obviously is a trait probably of women more inherently, but certainly of ours, so.
Hello, passionate restaurant owners and managers. I have some very exciting news for you all. Touch Bistro iPad POS. They want to make your life easier. Easier. Doesn't that sound lovely? Music to the ears. So they are an iPad POS company, and they want to talk to you about making your business better. For Touch Bistro, they get restaurants. I love this company. When I was running restaurants, I wished my POS could help me be even more of a superstar than I was. Seriously, Touch Bistro helps you do exactly that by giving you super detailed sales reports so you can tweak your menu on the fly. Or when your servers are taking orders, they can just take the iPad to the table and voila, the order goes straight from the table to the kitchen and bar. So no more mistakes. It's true. Now, Touch Bistro is not just for full service restaurants, food trucks, cafes, fast casual. Touch Bistro is definitely your solution. And did you know they are used in more than 10,000 restaurants in more than 100 countries? So tons of people like them, not just me. I just do really love them. Touch Bistro, they're great. So I have a great deal for you all. If you go to touchbistro.com/justforkingaround, that's touchbistro.com/justforkingaround. Enter in my promo code. It's Debbie20, DEBI20, and you will get 20% discounted when you sign up. 20%. That's huge. So just go to touchbistro.com/justforkingaround and enter in promo code Debbie20, D-E-B-I-2-0. Enjoy. There's something cool I was reading about, something about this Punchian cask. And you were saying, you know, when you say Google says, when you Google that, you guys are the only ones perhaps using this. So what is, it sounds pretty cool. Punchian cask.
Yeah, it's pronounced Punchian.
Okay. Excuse me. It's Punchian.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. And it's a barrel. It's a larger barrel than you would, than you would normally see whiskey aged in. It's actually most often used as a white wine barrel, like Chardonnay in particular. So it's almost double the size of a 53 gallon. It's about 120 gallons. And so the 53 gallons are, you know, when you go to, you know, like a normal distillery, you'll see a bunch of 53 gallon barrels.
Right.
So we're working with a much larger volume, and a couple of reasons we went that direction. One, you know, people, there's been a lot written and said about the growing whiskey industry and how it's put a pressure on the associated vendors, right? So, in the case of barrels, there's this like big barrel shortage, happening in the US right now. As a reminder, bourbon has to be aged in new white American oak barrels. So every time you're making a batch of bourbon, you're needing brand new white American oak barrels. So
wow, right? I mean, yeah. If you think about it, wow, yeah. That's a lot of barrels.
It's a lot of barrels. It's a lot of wood, and it's in fairly old and kind of like quiet, a small group of people that are in this business, right? I mean, you can't just go start up like a barrel making facility. They're called cooperages. Like they're not, you know, they're not easy to do.
And it's like a dance, isn't it? They're kind of banging and running at the way that they handcraft.
Yeah, they're really all handmade. I mean, you're taking like, you know, metal hoops and you know, kind of like forcing them around the top, bottom, and middle of the barrels to make sure that the wood is bent in the right way and doing it all in a way that's liquid tight. It's pretty amazing. It's a very old skill. And so anyway, the barrel shortage and the crush on the industry has led to a lot of kiln-dried barrels, meaning they're using wood that's kiln-dried, not naturally air-dried. And we really wanted to kind of stay true to what we think produces higher quality outcomes, which is air dried wood. So we basically looked to the wine industry to provide our barrels, and so the Punchians are come out of the Napa region, and there's also going to be a difference in the ratio of like liquid to wood, which we think is going to be helpful. It may take a little longer for our bourbon to come to term. But it won't be over oaked. We know that, and we think a lot of whiskeys fall prey to this. Kind of like you want to put it out fast, so you put it in a smaller barrel. It gets a ton of wood per volume, and it kind of is just too oaky. So, yeah, that it's a risk. I mean, for sure. And there's not a lot of people doing it. In fact, like you said, we don't know of anyone else kind of aging bourbon in Punchians, but we're excited to try it.
Yeah, no, I think that's so cool. I just totally educated because I always think about the 53 gallon barrels, and I know that you have to use them once, but as my consumer mind thinks, I wasn't thinking that there was like a finite, you know, kind of. And then when you say kiln dried, so how does it compromise the integrity of the wood or what versus air?
Exactly. So, you know, there's the whole process of like, you know, cutting down a tree, cutting the wood into the specific sizes it needs, letting it dry, like charring it, you know, toasting it, everything that goes into creating a barrel, all of the kind of like organic chemical reactions that happen are imparted into the liquid that, you know, you eventually drink in a cocktail. Mm. So trying to sort of cheat nature in this process, typically is a failure, typically produces lower quality spirit in the end, whether you're trying to kind of put out a younger bourbon that really isn't that good, but like, you know, you found some way to do it, right? There's all these things people are trying. Like, what if you put it on a boat because it's constantly moving and the constant movement will like, you know, or sound vibration. What if you like are raging like you know, like hard drumming beats at your barrels all day. You know, it's crazy. So we kind of were like, no, like, you know, the original method is has worked forever. And like, you just can't cheat time. So, you know, gotta be patient.
Yeah, that's like crazy. So with the space, just before we move on to your products, with the space, so is it, there's, it looked like it was open to the street, to the sidewalk, like that you could see in, and then there's, is it 1-4 and then there's glass and you can see the stills and everybody, is there the labeling and the bottling there as well? Or is that on a different level?
No, so it's a 2-floor facility, but the first floor is the cocktail bar kind of right on the corner where you enter. And we do have a really nice, like big roll up pivot door essentially that, and when the weather's nice, it's, you know, you feel like you're right outside.
Yeah.
And that's sort of like its own smaller area there around in the bar. And then, but you can still see right into the rest of the facility. And this, by the way, is also like comes down to some regulation because the law is, you know, different about where you're actually consuming the spirit versus making it. It's crazy. There's like a million laws we have to, abide
put
by.
Yellow tape. Don't go over the yellow tape if you have a drink.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Literally. orange in our case, but yeah.
Oh, really? Okay, literally.
yeah. All that stuff. So then the rest of the first floor facility is where we do the distilling, bottling, you know, all of the casing. It's also where, you know, we'll clean everything up and host big events like weddings and conferences in there. We've had a great interest in the space as an event space, which has been awesome.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And then the second floor is our barrel room where everything
is. Can you see the barrel room?
You can't really, I mean, if you look closely from the street, like you looked up, you might notice some barrels up there, but the floors are tall in that building. So you don't, you know, the first floor takes a lot of visual space.
Right. Cool. I love it. And when I love the product. So what's so interesting to me is every bottle, you know, it's a different shape, the labels, this is the house of brands. Now I get it. You have you have the Rodham Rye, the Burrow Bourbon and the Civic Vodka.
Yes. Also, an apple brandy which was just released, in November called Chapman's Apple Brandy.
Okay. I was wondering I knew that was coming. I didn't know. So it was Chapman. Now is that, we'll get to the naming. So your flagship started with the Civic
yeah.
Vodka. So it's corn?
Corn base.
Yep. Corn base. And there's something cool about the bottle. Can you tell me a little about the packaging and the bottle and then the actual, your ingredients, or your process? I don't know if you can give any secrets away, but.
Yeah. So, the bottle itself is interesting. So we were talking to a lot of bartenders about this, and especially women said to us, you know, these crazy unusual shapes become really difficult when you're bartending because either they're too large, you can't really hold them properly, or they've got, you know, kind of like weird, like, you know, shapes and designs that just are not comfortable and uniform for a bar setting. So they sort of advised us, like, you know, when you design your bottle, make sure to keep that in mind.
That's brilliant. I love that you asked the bartenders or that you took some of their intel. It's brilliant.
Yeah. So we had the like general shape in our mind. We wanted something sort of tall with a bottle with tall shoulders, short neck. And we worked with our designer on this to, you know, think about how we could put like a custom stamp on it. So the front of it has the what you'd imagine the right side of a diamond to be. And that's sort of like a reminder of the part of the district where we're located, District of Columbia, in basically a diamond shape, and we're in the northeast quadrant. And then on the bottom of the bottle is an emboss of our name, and on the very bottom there's also our logo. So we had a couple kind of custom designs in the actual glass itself, and then the decal obviously was designed to fit the brand. But yeah, it's been really fun to do a custom bottle. It's not something that companies our size normally do, but
yeah, it's a custom. And then, so with the bottles, those are labels there? Is it hand labeled? Do you guys do the labeling there? Or how does that work?
The, so different for each. So the Civic, brand the bottles come with the decals baked on. As
yeah, it looks like it wasn't stuck on. It looks cool.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not a paper label. It's a decal that gets literally baked in an oven.
Cool.
The Burrow and Rodham and Chapman labels are all applied in-house. They're Rodham by hand, and the Chapman and Burrow, we use a small little like labeling machine. It's not fancy, but it does the trick.
And so tell me about the Civic. Is the corn, what's the inspiration or the flavor profile that you're trying to get to? I know that vodka doesn't really have a flavor profile, but they all do.
They all do. Exactly. And so we were, what we were getting after with Civic is a product that could be, you know, really widely distributed and consumed, something that would be a palate pleaser to, you know, most consumers, and something that's, you know, affordable enough that bars, restaurants could use this on the menu. People could feel like they were drinking our spirit as an everyday choice. One of the concepts we realized, in our research was that a lot of consumers were choosing craft maybe once, because they, you know, they liked the company or they went on a tour. Maybe they were buying a bottle as a gift, but they were going back to these like multinational brands for their everyday choice. And what we wanted to do is sort of disrupt that and become the everyday choice. Well, you can't do that if it's too expensive. So keeping price in mind as we develop Civic was really important, and it is for all the brands. Actually, we're compare us to most craft, we're more affordable.
Yeah, the price point on that is very approachable. I mean, it's just cool.
So Civic is 100% corn based. We think it provides a sort of a slightly sweeter, rounder mouthfeel. Not like sugary sweet. There's nothing added to it, obviously, but just a slight like hint of sweetness using the corn. We also obviously, are in deep with corn, if you will, when it comes to bourbon. So we liked the idea of sticking with it for Civic. What makes Civic, we think, so unique is that we've developed a filtration system that really like enhances and provides a like level of smoothness and cleanness that you don't often find in craft vodkas. So, you know, the chemical that most people react to in vodka is acetone.
What's it? It's acetone?
Acetone, yeah. I mean, it's what makes you feel like there's like a burning instinct, that it's like, you know, kind of like astringent and strong, and that we've removed through our filtration process. So what's left from it, it goes through a coconut, basically a charred coconut shell filtration system. It sounds weird, but like you can make, you know, filters are often made out of charcoal. You can use anything that was formerly living to create charcoal. And in this case, it's a coconut shell husk that was charred to use as the filter.
That's cool. Yeah. It says activated coconut shell carbon. I've read that and I was just, so it's cool. I love all that you're doing. I mean, it seems really like unique and smart and just definitely unique.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah, it is. It is unique, and it's hopefully not so unique that it's like a one-time thing. But it's been good. People have responded really well to it. Vodka should, enhance the cocktail. It should be something that lifts up the other ingredients, whether it's as simple as a martini or, you know, it's got like citrus and juice in it and things that, you know, really shine in a big way. But, it's that like underlying flavor kind of profile of vodka that just is like an enhancer that's what makes it good. And so we're pretty happy with it.
Nice. I love that. And it's Civic. And I saw your t-shirts. I like your merch. I love your merch. It's awesome. So I want to talk about the Burrow, and I want to talk about the Rodham, and I love the bottles. So maybe let's start. I saw a picture of Hillary Clinton, and I'm assuming that the Rodham Rye has to do a little bit with that naming. Can you tell us a little bit about the Rodham Rye?
Yeah, so we were sitting around in the spring of 2016, hoping and assuming, maybe that was a mistake, but assuming that we would be having like this historic inauguration come to DC, much like the 2008 Obama inauguration, which, you know, for the local economy is kind of like the Olympics, right?
Right.
So, you know, what could we do to celebrate it as like a women-owned, you know, manufacturing facility? Could we do something special, you know, to you know, sort of contribute our part to the party, what we thought would be a party? Fast forward to the Wednesday after the election, and we decided to invest in a 3.5-year-old rye that we had tasted and really enjoyed, and knew we could secure about 20 barrels of. Which is not a lot, but it was like enough to create a little run of it that, you know, would be, we thought, you know, bought and sold and consumed during that
youth of celebration. Yeah.
So anyway, so we spent the money on it, and, you know, we're beginning to get the brand ready. We were, you know, nearly done with the design when the election happened, and Rachel called me. I was in the Phoenix airport, and she said, "What do you want to do about Rodham?" And we just really weren't sure. We put it on hold for a few weeks, I guess, maybe about 10 days, actually, just to kind of, you know, regroup with ourselves, kind of like see what was going to happen.
Yeah.
And then, you know, and during that period of time, we were talking about it with friends, and people were like, just do it. You know, I mean, now, maybe now more than ever, like, let's design a brand and celebrate women, you know, Hillary Clinton included, but lots of other women that, you know, don't always get the kind of notoriety that they deserve. And so anyway, we went forward with it and launched it in March, almost a year ago, for Women's History Month. So we had a little delay in the launch, but you know, it's been great. And 10% of proceeds of Rodham go to support Emily's List, an organization that I've been, you know, close with professionally over the years. And go select women, you know, up and down the ticket.
Yeah, I love it. And it's a great bottle. It's a great label. I mean, I like the design. It's awesome. I do. It's sharp. It's great. I love it. So what about the bourbon?
So bourbon is our bridge between, you know, where we are today and when we can launch our own in-house bourbon. So, you know, as a reminder, the process to distill bourbon and age it really takes a few years at a minimum. And
yeah, if you want to remind us, because some people might not remember, because you know, so, it gets confusing with all the bourbon whiskey, right?
Yeah. So whiskey is a category, and bourbon is a type, rye is a type, right? So they're both whiskeys, bourbon and rye, but you know, bourbon in this case comes off of the still clear. Some people don't know that, but you know, when you're making bourbon, you're starting with a high amount of corn. It's got to be 51% or higher. Some amount of barley usually, and then some people will add other things like a little bit of rye or wheat or something. But 51% of it is corn, and it goes through the process of brewing, fermenting, and then distilling. And yeah, it comes out, you know, very crystal clear. It's called new make at that point. It's not really whiskey.
It's called new make.
Yeah, new make.
Okay.
Yeah. And then it goes into the barrel, and it's the oak that imparts the color and the flavor that you would think of when you think of bourbon. So you could, you know, you could release a 1-year-old bourbon. There's no mandatory time on that. Some people think it's got to be, you know, only made in Kentucky, only got to age for 3 years. I swear the Kentucky school system is like promoting this, like, this myth that you can only, like, you know, bourbon's only made in Kentucky.
Right. Yeah, like champagne.
Yeah, exactly. But that's not
so
the case.
I'm sorry, Pia, you don't have to age it for like 3 years. So I always thought for some reason, see, I'm under the magical spell there. I thought that, I knew it didn't have to be made in Kentucky, but I did think there had to be something like, you know, 3 years or something. I don't know.
No.
Wow, cool. That's good intel.
It's something that everybody thinks, but no, so that's not the case. So it needs a few years, and Rachel and I really feel committed to this idea that if we're not putting out whiskeys that we would want to drink, we're failing. And, you know, bourbon that's only been aging for a year, maybe a year and a half, like, it's just not ready. So anyway, we're looking at still another couple of years before we're releasing our own.
You started the process?
Not of releasing, but of distilling.
Distilling, yes. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That's exciting.
Yeah, it is. It's been really fun. And, you know, we've been able to experiment and try some different things. So it's been great. But in the meantime, we're selling Burrow Bourbon, which we're on batch two right now. Batch one, ran out in, nice. About, the summer. Yeah. So
that's a good sign.
it is. People love it. It's, batch two is finished in house in rum casks, which is our way of kind of putting a stamp on our product and making it a little bit different. And most people really have never had bourbon that was finished in rum casks. So people say it smells like a rum and drinks like a bourbon.
Sounds delicious. Yeah.
Yeah. So Burrow is the definition of Burrow is like the most basic form of self-governed territory. You know, people might associate it with like New York City with the five boroughs, but, it's also used a lot out west as, you know, smaller, or maybe actually larger than like a county or a municipality, but like the most basic form of regulated territory. So yeah, so it was sort of like a tip of the hat to the fact that like, you know, we didn't distill it. We're not trying to make, you know, fool anyone with it. We want to be really clear about the fact that like, you know, Burrow was distilled by other teams, but we brought it in house, finished it, aged it, and in this case, are bottling it. So
right, and then it's also under your house, so we trust in the transparency. So there's that whole kind of thread to it, yeah. And then the one other one that I have to try to find the label. I'm not looking at it. The your newest edition,
Chapman's,
Chapman.
So Chapman's Apple Brandy is our first in-house aged and distilled spirit.
Congrats.
Thank you.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
That's awesome.
It's been really exciting process. Really, Rachel gets all the credit for experimenting with apple brandy. And we built a relationship with a farmer in Adams County, Pennsylvania. He's an orchardist, grows a ton of great apples. Really smart guy, our generation. And we worked with Ben is his name to bring in as much fresh pressed apple juice as we could, apple cider really, because it's got all the pulp and skin and everything on it, and fermented it in house and then distilled it and aged it, and out came this really really wonderful product. It's super sweet, you know, very apple-y. It's almost like you're sticking your nose inside an apple core.
Wow.
And the more research we did on apple brandy, we kind of like, you know, unearthed this incredible history involving Johnny Appleseed, whose last name was Chapman. And
his last name was Chapman, yeah, when he came over. Yeah, tell the story. Tell a little bit. This is awesome.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, Johnny Appleseed, his last name is Chapman. You know, kids learn about him as like, you know, spreading the gospel of apples, around the, you know, Ohio River Valley, you know, including Maryland, Pennsylvania, and kind of our region there. So, but there's more to it than that. He kind of thought that, you know, if you figure out how to grow apples, if you figure out how to grow an orchard, that's like creating wealth, that's the same wealth. And you know, he had this really kind of, populist viewpoint on life that, you know, out of apples could come like wealth, success, and happiness. And especially, in the new land, you know, so that was really interesting. And then also during Prohibition, the FBI was actually going out and about and like chopping down apple trees because people were, you know, at home making brandy and cider. And when Prohibition landed, not only did they, you know, everyone seen the famous photos of, you know, government officials like dumping barrels of whiskey in the street, but they also went out and literally cut down apple trees. So
wow, I didn't know that.
Anyway,
dang.
Yeah, we really didn't know any of this, but it all kind of took place in our backyard. And
wow, so cool.
Yeah.
Dang. So Chapman, is that something that are you going to continue, or how do you keep distilling? And
yes.
So say you've in-house distilled it. Now you've done the same. So the apples, the same varietal. I mean, how does that work?
Yeah. Yeah. So what we're doing is we're using all for last year and this year, all fruit grown on Ben's farm. And he grows Johnnigold, Gala, Fuji, and Honeycrisp.
Okay.
So it's a combination of all of those. He sells whole fruit to farmers markets and whatnot. But what we're using are his seconds most often. So, you know, fruit that's like maybe two brews to sell at your farmer's market, but absolutely perfect for...
Or like a weird shape. Yeah,
exactly. So it goes to a press house in Adams County and then trucked down to our facility. So last year's release was the 2016 harvest. The 2018 release will be the 2017 harvest, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So we're currently actually in the facility. We've got 8 totes of apple cider that's fermenting right now. It'll get distilled and put in the barrel, and then we'll take on another batch as soon as we can. We'll take as much as Ben has.
Right. That's so cool.
Been super good.
So,
yeah.
So it must feel, so you've always had the vodka, and then I know your agings for your your bourbons and your whiskeys, but you have this apple brandy. So it must really start to feel like the movement of distilling of with the barrels and really kind of thinking ahead and kind of having to taste, and it must really start to be really a little bit more real and exciting.
Yeah, it totally is. We now have a fairly full suite of products, which has been great. You know, we can now when we're selling to, you know, our wholesale accounts, we can provide, you know, a number of options for them, which has been fun. So we're just growing into Maryland right now. We're spending a lot of time in Baltimore, you know, meeting with bar and restaurant owners and, you know, kind of trying to lay the groundwork for the company up there. It's much easier to go into those conversations with, you know, 4 products.
Right. So that's, you have 4 products. And so when you scale, you're obviously scaling as best as you can support the scale, right?
Yeah.
Going into other states regulation wise, like you, or is it what you can service? Like how does that work?
It's a combination. So the state laws all kind of handle this a little bit differently, but broadly speaking, we have this 3-tiered system still post prohibition, where the manufacturer has to be different from the distributor, who has to be different from the supplier. So you know, we are in your home state, you're able to. You're able to be both the wholesaler and the distributor, but in most other states you can't. However, there's been this movement to create exceptions for small distillers. So in Maryland, if you're under 100,000 proof gallons per year, you're able to self-distribute. Obviously, they're not thinking people are going to be driving in from thousands of miles away. They're assuming, rightly so, that this is going to benefit the sort of regional companies like ours that. Yeah. For us, Maryland is obviously 3 miles away. So,
So that's pretty cool. So that's awesome. So
yeah.
When I think about your distillery and what you're up to in like a year or in 2 years, what are we going to keep the same theme of the house with the different
brands? Yeah,
and kind of continue down that. And do you see are there other things that you want to start experimenting with or exploring, other type of spirits or liqueurs?
Yeah, I think if the first year and a half is marked by us really growing the brand family, I think the next year and a half will be more about market growth than it will brands. Although, you know, we've got some stuff in the works right now. So we'll see. I mean, we might try our hand at a gin.
Do you like gin personally?
No. I don't hate it.
No, I know. It's like you're not a gin drinker, right? Is Rachel?
No.
What about rum?
No.
Rum?
No. She prefers tequila. And caveat that no one wants to drink what you make all day long, right? So, Rachel definitely, if she's going to have a cocktail, it's going to be tequila or nothing these days. usually a beer or wine, and kind of myself included. Although my go-to will be a bourbon Manhattan.
Do you drink wine?
I do.
Yeah,
I do. My wife thinks that whiskey tastes like gasoline, which is interesting. Yeah. Thing.
Because you got married. I know you got married last year. Congratulations.
Thank you. So she's big into red wine. So that's a lot of what's happening in my house.
Awesome. I have a question. I try to figure this out. I know this seems strange, but I try to figure out what astrological sign you are now that I've been talking to you. Okay. So I know this is, it's tough. I'm having a tough time with it because you have this I want to say Capricorn style, seriousness, but yet you have a playfulness. So I think you're like a monkey Chinese wise, I think. But I think, and so I'm having a hard time. I'm thinking I think that Rachel's a Virgo. And I think that you are, you could be a Libra or a Pisces.
Interesting. You're wrong on both, but I don't but I don't know enough really to like tell you what aspects you're wrong on, right on. But no, I'm a Cancer Gemini cusp.
Dang.
Yeah. And but I think I'm the year of monkey, 1980.
Yeah, you are monkey. Okay. So I got half right. I said monkey there.
And Rachel's Sagittarius.
Oh, so Sag. Okay. I just went off of a picture. That's interesting. The reason why I was going Virgo, I find that a lot of winemakers, distillers, there's a very organized and methodic and into cleaning because everything has to be so clean that usually they're Virgos. So that was, why I was going to say that. And then Cancers, what's so interesting, Pia, is Cancers usually are the most predominant in the food industry, which is interesting. Yeah, just from my experience over these years. Yeah. So you're on the cusp there.
And yeah, excellent. I'm on the cusp.
I wouldn't have said Gemini. Interesting. Mm-hmm. Cool. Well, thank you for sharing that. You're awesome. So did I miss anything? I know that we got to kind of wind it down, but did I miss anything that you, that we need to talk about on here with your awesome, badass distillery?
No, I think it's been great. I mean, you know, for people that are listening, supporting your local distillers or any small craft distillers, is so, so important. People often ask us like who our biggest competition is. And, you know, we don't feel like we're in competition with other craft distillers. There's so few of us. There's only about 1,000, active distilleries in the US. So, it's all of us against the Bacardis of the world and Absolutes of the world. So,
So choose.
Choose local, choose small.
Yeah.
When you can, choose women owned.
I love it. Yeah. I mean, women owned, it's spectacular. So thank you so much for what you're doing. I find your story amazing. I think you're awesome and I'm excited too. I don't get to DC often. I'm actually from Boston, but DC's in that little pocket but if I do and when I do, I'm totally coming to see you. And
please do.
Yeah. And if you come to LA, I'm in Santa Monica now. You have to come see me.
I would love to. We'll toast in person.
Yeah. It'd be amazing. All right. Pia Carasone. I had it right at the beginning. Pia Carasone. Yes. That's it. Got it. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me on, Debbie.
Awesome. Hey, everybody. I hope you enjoyed listening to that episode. And again, please rate and review if you did like this podcast episode or any of the other ones. Please go to iTunes, download, rate, review. I appreciate that very much. Just Forking Around Podcast. And again, I am Debbie Salzberg. My handle on Instagram is @ForkingPodcast. My website is justforkingaround.net. And I am so excited to have you on board here with me on the Just Forking Around podcast. And I look forward to seeing you on the next show.